Hey, what's up, y'all? Welcome back to another episode of Who Are We? My name is Catrice Roots, the creator of this series. And in memory of my grandmother today, I want to do an episode based on Sister Rosetta Tharpe. Yes, the godmother, the grandmother, the queen of rock and roll, pretty much. So let's roll that intro. All right, so like I said, I wanted to do this in memory of my grandmother. My grandmother, she passed away years ago, but my mom was just on her so much recently. And I never forget, she would tell me stories about how her mother used to listen to Sister Rosetta Tharpe. And, you know, me growing up, I've never heard of somebody from that generation playing, like a black woman playing like rock and roll blues type of stuff on a guitar and singing, and became like a super famous gospel singer, one of the first famous gospel singers, honestly, other than Thomas A. Dorsey and stuff. Anyways, let's get to all this. All right, so born March 20th, 1915, Rosetta Newbin Atkins, okay? That's her real name, or maiden name. She was born in a cotton plant, now known born in a she was born pretty much on a cotton plantation, now known as Woodruff County, Arkansas. I don't know about you guys, every single time I see the word Arkansas, I be getting ready to say Arkansas. Tharpe is known as one of gospel music's first, like I said, like superstar, celebrity, click, 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 popsy, ropsy type of stuff, you know, on that level of fame back then with gospel music. She influenced artists such as Bob Dylan, Little Richard, Elvis Presley, Johnny Cash, and so many others that I'm not naming, but those are just a few that I know y'all would probably notice. Tharpe's mother, Katie Bell Newbin Atkins, was an evangelist, singer, and mandolin player for the Church of God in Christ. So Rosetta Tharpe already grew up with like seeing a image of a woman, her mother, heavily into music. So obviously, you know, she was already gonna grow up being like a prodigy. Tharpe's father was Willis Atkins. There's not much on him, but he was a pastor. Other than him like being a pastor or minister, Tharpe started performing and playing the guitar at the age of 4. By the time Tharpe was 6, she regularly performed gospel mixed secular music styles with her mom. So she already knew the whole flow of what she was gonna grow into later on in life. Although she was a good singer, her guitar skills overshined her singing, because like I said, back then it wasn't a lot of female guitar players, let alone black female guitar players and singers like that, you know, like where they playing the guitar, like she was playing the guitar on like some blues rock and roll level. It wasn't no simple guitar chords. No, she was all that type of stuff. Tharpe's guitar style was influenced by her mother's mandolin playing style. So mandolin, guitar, both string instruments. So yeah. Tharpe's singing style and choice in music was influenced by the hymns of Thomas A. Dorsey. So she already had that inspiration there from somebody that, you know, made it big in the gospel industry and literally created gospel pretty much. So yeah, she already had somebody to look up to and really take it to a whole nother level with gospel music. As she grew into a young woman, Tharpe's style started to become more influenced by jazz musicians such as Cab Calloway and Lucky Millinder. By the time Rosetta Tharpe was in her 30s, she moved to New York due to the advice from her Chicago promoters. They were like, yo, like, you're really good. Like, you got to take your talent to the next level. Chicago, it helped you get up there, but you know, New York, y'all know how New York was back then. It was like the Hollywood back then, you know, like your music could really catch on. Your creativity could really catch on at the masses if you performed out in New York. And that's exactly what she did. She moved to New York. And while she was in New York, she married a minister, Thomas A. Tharp, in 1934. And although they divorced in 1943, she still kept his last name as a stage name, which honestly, I don't blame her, because Rosetta Tharp has a way better ring to it than Rosetta Atkins. Like we talked about in Fats Waller episode, sometimes people, actual names, doesn't look like them, you know what I'm saying? Like, Fats Waller's real name was Thomas. Anyways, Rosetta Tharp's real name, I didn't even know her last name was Atkins. Like, Rosetta Atkins, that doesn't flow like a artist name, you know? Some people, I'm so glad she just kept the last name Tharp. That just flows like a stage name, you know? Anyways, Tharp was so popular during that time that she was one of the only two black gospel acts during that time. It was her and the Dixie Hummingbirds. She also had the opportunity to perform at Carnegie Hall in 1938. She was a big hit right after that performance. It was like Carnegie Hall was kind of like what made you, or what would make you or break you as an artist back then. So if you could amaze people with your performance at Carnegie Hall, then boom, you're going on tour. And that's exactly what happened to her. She blew up after that and went on tour all throughout the Northeast side of the United States. So obviously that just honestly kept her career going. And Tharp continued to perform until her death, which was October 9th, 1973. So rest in peace to her, and just thank you so much. I just wanna say thank you for like breaking barriers with not just gospel music. It's like she broke so many barriers all at one time. Like, she broke barriers as in a way of like mixing blues and jazz with gospel music. And gospel music itself was already breaking barriers with Thomas A. Dorsey, which is our last episode. So it's like this episode is kind of like a continuation throughout the timeline with gospel music, with Rosetta Tharp now. But it's like she already broke barriers with gospel music to make it more, have a more of a groove to it, have more of like a modern, it's like staying up to date with stuff, you know, and keeping it interesting and captivating. So it's like she did that, and she was breaking barriers for black women that like playing the guitar, and she made that like a normal image in society, to where it's like women in general playing the guitar was looked at as being normal, and now black women playing the guitar was also being looked at as normal, all because of Rosetta Tharp, you know, because it was just so rare, like, man. And some of her most well-known songs were Didn't It Rain, That's All,
People Biting One Another. You know, they think they're doing swell, and all they want is your money, and you can go to all this all. Well, that's all.
And Up Above My Head. And She has so many others that I cannot name right now. But those are some of the main ones that I grew up hearing when my grandma would mention her, and like we looked her up on YouTube. I'm like, oh wow, like she's like, wow, like why don't people talk about her more? You know, it's like she's starting to get a little bit more notoriety now, but back then when my grandmother had mentioned her, I'm like, I've never heard this. Like her, she should be in Black history. Like, you know how schools always like to repeat the same Black history? She should be one of those people in constant repeat of Black history. So, you know, because like, why do we not know about her as often? But that's this episode. Thank you guys for watching. As you guys can tell, there's a lot of changes. I took a long break. I went to New York. You guys go and check out that vlog. You know, if you want to feel like you're in New York and get good vibes, look at that vlog. You know, and I just needed a break from creating content. Sometimes you need that break to build up on more people to research, you know, because I was writing out some people, you know, to research, but I was like, nah, I don't want to do this. Nah, I don't want to do that. You know what I'm saying? But, you know, I got a thick stack of people that, you know, I can come out with every single week until the last week of December. For the last week of December, that will be the last episode of Who Are We? For season one. I'll be back for season two sometime in 2022. I don't know when, but I'll be back definitely. I may take another month or 2 months. I may come back during Black History Month, you know, take a month of a break, build up on some people, and then come back in Black History Month. But thank you guys for watching. Thank you guys for supporting. Thank you guys for supporting my merch. That's another thing. I will be transitioning my merch store, so be on the lookout for that. So by our next Who Are We episode next week, I should be with a completely different merch store with way more merchandise and accessories for you guys to purchase or whatever. So yeah, other than that, you guys have a great day, and I will see you guys next week.